Hello, everyone. Welcome to this Peace Alliance Winnipeg webinar entitled Manufacturing Consent for War in Canada and the United States. My name is Radhika Desai. I'm a member of Peace Alliance Winnipeg, and I also teach politics at the university here in Winnipeg at the University of Manitoba. And it's a great pleasure to be here, and I'm very much looking forward to this, as I know all of you are. Our two speakers, Yves Engler and Colleen Bell, have solid research behind them, and they're going to, I think, really inform us very well on the topic. It's generally, of course, said that the truth is the first casualty of war. But what Colleen and Yves are going to tell us today and talk about today is that the injury to truth actually begins a long time before any guns are ever fired. Now, in our presentation, in our webinar, Colleen is going to speak about the United States mainly, but not exclusively. And Yves is going to speak mainly, but not exclusively, about Canada. Now, even in the case of the United States, which has, of course, been the leading factor, the leading country in the overwhelming majority of the wars that we have and in the current war over Ukraine. But even in the case of the United States, it's not entirely clear exactly why it wishes to pursue this war. Many people argue that this is perhaps a war as much against Europe and China as it is against Russia. And if you ask ordinary Americans on the street, they also feel that this is a war that is as much against them, given that they are the ones who are suffering the difficulties and the economic dislocations that it involves. And even though, of course, American soldiers are not fighting and dying there, nevertheless, the American people are paying a price for it. We know, of course, that the military-industrial complex would like this war. Perhaps we think that some other sections of American industry may want it. But what is increasingly clear is that there being a lack of economic rationale, that certain opinion makers, think tanks, newspapers are sort of playing a very big role in this. It's just some thoughts that I have as a non-expert observer, but it seems to me that this ideological thrust is very great, and I'm hoping that Colleen's presentation will tell us more about it. The Canadian case is even more interesting and intriguing, given that Canada is not the leading capitalist power. But having said that, Canada, and Yves knows more about this and has written about this extensively, Canada has always been part of the imperial system, very favorably nestled in a comfortable niche within the imperial system. And today, what you find is that Canada must try to balance, on the one hand, its reliance on this imperial system. When I say its reliance, I mean the reliance of its ruling classes on this imperial system, on the one hand, and the increasing inadequacy of these structures of imperialism on the other. And again, I'm sure that Yves will tell us about that. So with these thoughts in my mind, let me not detain our speakers any further. We agreed that we would have Colleen speak first, and then it will be followed by Yves. And I will introduce the speakers as they come. So let me begin by introducing Colleen. But before I do that, let me also say that both the speakers will speak for about 20 minutes each. And then we will open up for a broader discussion, taking questions and answers from the floor. And we hope that we will end this event today at about the 90-minute mark, maybe a little later, depending on how much interest there is. So with that said, let me introduce Colleen Bell. Colleen Bell is Associate Professor in the Department of Political Studies at the University of Saskatchewan. She's an international relations scholar who specializes in theorizing war and security and the contested boundary between military and civilian operations in Western counterterrorism. This should be fascinating, of course, because of the extent to which the boundaries between war and peace are getting blurred today. So she's also the author of Freedom of Security, Governing Canada in the Age of Counterterrorism, which was brought out by UBC Press, and co-editor of War, Police, and Assemblages of Intervention with Jan Bachmann and Caroline Holmqvist. Currently, she's working on projects that examine police power in global politics, martial public diplomacy, and the security politics of Canada's feminist foreign policy. Colleen Bell is past president of the International Studies Association Canada, and currently she is the editor of a journal called Critical Studies on Security. So, Colleen, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Radhika. Thanks also to Paul and the Peace Alliance Winnipeg for the invitation to present today. I'm zooming in from Treaty 6 territory and the homeland of the Métis, the Dene Sulin, the Cree, Nakoda, Sioux, and Soto people. I'm going to share my screen because I do have some slides. How's that? Good? Okay, well, thank you again. So today I want to discuss the central role of media in defining and framing issues for the public. The media environment has arguably changed in the last couple of decades or so with the growth of social media, but I would contend that the media still tells us what is important and worth caring about and who the key actors are and what roles they play. It's also the case that Western publics are positioned as both consumers and spectators in relation to wars. We're on the one hand at a distance, and we're subject to media accounts that are often stylized around our roles as onlookers of other people's tragedy. Which does fickle consumers whose attention has to be titillated to be maintained. But I also think publics are at a disadvantage in being able to access news and media and that they can trust, and which does not largely represent the government side or increasingly sources that engage in disinformation about the causes and consequences of war. But what I'd like to underscore is that thinking about war and the media requires us to think about how in any given war that the media is covering, there's actually two wars. There's the real war of people dying and fighting, and there's the media war, which is the sanitized, consumable, contained representations of conflict. And so the argument that I want to kind of put forward today is that governments, and especially defense ministries, have an outsized impact in shaping how wars are presented to us, and that traditional media is increasingly in the pocket of departments of national defense. And consequently, the mainstream media often presents wars to us as inevitable, that when we engage in war, it's because there's no other choice or options available. It also presents wars to us as clean. There's this kind of continuous message that our people, despite fighting in wars, are avoiding bloodshed, that bloodshed's not really happening or isn't like a central aspect of fighting. And that the consequence of actions, that wars themselves are the consequence of the actions of our adversaries, not us. And thus I contend that there's a convergence of US national security state and media corporations in a geopolitical economic nexus. And I'd like to say a few things about how they work together to sell Western publics commodified images and stories that shore up that power. And so I think this begs the question of why, you know, this is the case. Why does the media have this pattern of presenting wars as inevitable and clean? And I think one of the answers is that defense ministries and governments have too much influence over the media. And I want to discuss how this influence and control is exercised. My focus is mainly on the US context, but as Radhika suggested, I would argue that understanding this context is highly relevant to Canada, and some of the arguments can be carried over to Canada. And this is because Canada and traditional media outlets are deeply engaged in consuming and reproducing American media, but we also have many of the same patterns in our own media. And so, and broadly, I would say Canadians are very much affected by patterns, by these patterns that I'm gonna speak to today. So broadly, I wanna talk about the rise of information operations, media shaping and control and what that looks like in practical terms, in terms of what we could call, and I borrow this from Tanner Mirley's sourcing strategies, which includes how they produce conflict, the embedding program, and pseudo events. I'm going to say a few things about coercion specifically of media, and then I have a few thoughts for the conclusion if we have time. Okay, so war and public relations, or what's sometimes called public communications, and I think also to some extent public diplomacy, have a long history of entanglement. And a really early important moment was in this history was the US government's decision to enter World War I. At that time, Woodrow Wilson, he declared war and then immediately created the Office of War Information under the pretext of needing to essentially sell the war to the American public, because the public was not remotely on side at all with entering that war. And decades later in Vietnam, there was talk of what was called the Vietnam syndrome, where there was noted public aversion to future wars because of, as we know, the disaster of that conflict. And the argument that was pursued was that the media's coverage of the heinous violence that was used to subdue the population, and certainly the humanitarian disaster that unfolded, led to a moral crisis that made not only the war end, but subsequent overseas missions publicly untenable. And from the vantage of defense strategists, this meant that there needed to be more effort to manage public opinion if the US was to engage in sort of future and subsequent conflicts. After Vietnam and certainly into the 1980s, there was a rapid development of psychological operations, or what are called PSYOPs programs. And I'll just note that these have undergone many changes in terms of how they're referred to in recent years. But essentially, these were programs in part that were focused on managing media coverage of war. The focus was to reduce the media's autonomy while increasing the Department of Defense's control over media coverage, and included national security directives to rebuild PSYOPs through the 1980s under the Reagan administration and beyond, and to integrate PSYOPs into military planning and operations directly. And, you know, by directly, I mean by embedding PSYOPs within the military and defense establishment permanently in times of both war and peace. And this approach was used in Grenada, Panama, Nicaragua, El Salvador, and really became routine. Then kind of moving ahead to the 1991 Gulf War, this approach has been documented to have taken a new twist when the Department of Defense engaged in a practice of total fabrication, so beyond spin, where it hired a PR firm that fabricated, and many of you will remember this story, about Iraqi soldiers apprehending a Kuwaiti neonatal hospital unit and removing babies from incubators. And this was noted as a strategy to get the American public on side with the military campaign. But it was really, I would suggest to you, the beginning of the global war on terror in 2001, where we saw a sweeping transition in how the Department of Defense sought to control public information about war. And this transition was underway a few years earlier, but really 1 month prior, 1 month following the Al-Qaeda attacks of 9/11, the US released the report of what's called the Defense Science Task Force on Managed Information Dissemination. And I think this was a really important moment. It's because this report essentially stated that, and I'm quoting, US civilian and military information dissemination capabilities are powerful assets vital to national security. They can create diplomatic opportunities, lessen tensions that might lead to war, help contain conflicts, and address non-traditional threats to America's interests. In the information age, no diplomatic or military strategy can succeed without them. And so I think what this was a new and more expansive way of thinking about the media and influence. And it was embodied in a new conception of military function called information operations. And in fact, information operations became formally codified in 2017 as a joint function within the US military that would then cross all the different components of the US military. But broadly, under this idea of information operations, I'd say there's two important aspects. The first is the media itself was reconceived as part of a much wider information environment. based on the idea that there are a range of actors that need to be accounted for in this new environment. And this is what the Department of Defense, but also I would say Department of National Defense in Canada and other defense ministries mean when they state that in the quote, information age, the military cannot succeed without addressing what it calls non-traditional threats to national security. The second element is that the rise of information operations involved the integrated employment of core capabilities. So this included electronic warfare, operational security, military deception, psyops, computer network operations. These all used to be treated as formally separate and became kind of like merged in terms of and sort of seen as very connected and integrated core capabilities. Now in 2003, all of this integration was laid out essentially in another important sort of document called the Information Operations Roadmap. And what it did is it described information operations as boundless, number one, meaning that it was not confined to like one space or territory or target. And targets of information operations are traditional media and Western publics, but also was taken to be citizen-based alternative media, adversary propaganda, the foreign populations, including but not limited to those residing in coalition theaters of operation. It was also described as permanent, meaning that it was, again, deployed in wartime, peacetime, and crisis time, and as both having offensive and defensive components. So an important military field manual called FM313, Information Operations, the first was released in 2003, and there are subsequent ones that have been released since. But they continue this pattern of recommending the kind of combined and simultaneous deployment of persuasive and coercive and offensive and defensive strategies, where offensive operations are aimed to like destroy, degrade, disrupt, deny, deceive, exploit, and influence adversary decision makers and anyone who's believed to affect the success of friendly operations, but also defensive, where it's about protecting and defending friendly information. So it has this kind of joint, this kind of dual function. And the other thing I would add is that information operations also now covers public affairs. And the military has its own public affairs department, its own set of field manuals and so forth. And states that public information and community relations activities, as well as civilian and NGO, organizations and leaders can be influenced and exploited to achieve operational objectives. So I'll suggest to you that I think one of the important outcomes of information operations integration, and I'm sorry, there's a lot of big words that, you know, are a little bit, you know, difficult to work with here. But this integration framework between defensive operations and civilian and military powers is that it deepened how much the media itself became like an object of control, if not suppression. And also that it produced facilitating conditions for additional fabrications that made it possible to launch new wars. And these fabrications, in fact, came from what was called the Office of Special Plans that the Department of Defense in 2002 created to provide intelligence about Iraq to senior government members of the Bush administration. And from the US front group, what's called the Iraqi National Congress, was an organization essentially created by the CIA following the Gulf War to essentially try to build Iraqi opposition to the Iraqi government. And it was this Office of Special Plans that essentially fabricated the evidence that had formed the basis of arguments within both the US and UK governments for the invasion of Iraq in 2003. As Seymour Hersh argued, the DOD established the Office of Special Plans to find evidence of what Donald Rumsfeld, the defense secretary at the time, wanted to be true. And all of this was facilitated by a kind of relationship that the DOD cultivated with the media. And we can call this the DOD's sort of military media sourcing strategy, if you like. And it has all of these components of experts for media appearances, the embedding program, the creation of information centers, what's called video news releases and segments of controlling information produced by the DOD, as well as pseudo events, and then some instances of direct coercion. So I'm going to say a couple things about a few of these because I don't have a ton of time, and then try to wrap up. So in terms of experts, the DoD created a military analyst program where it dispatched experts who were funded by or worked for the Department of Defense to essentially echo and amplify the DoD's preferred version of stories about both the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. As the New York Times discovered, this strategy was readily taken up by news networks and studios as though they were interviewing nonpartisan analysts. But in reality, these people were kind of force multipliers. They were force multiplying agents tasked with delivering content in the form of their own expert opinion. And according to News Corp Watch, which tracks corporate interests in the media milieu, journalists across the US network, cable and radio media quoted these analysts more than like 4,500 times. And their ties to the Department of Defense and US arms firms was essentially never disclosed.
15 minutes.
Thank you. In terms of the embedding program, the DoD built an elaborate embedding program for journalists to train, live, work, and travel with the military units in theater. And these were known as media boot camps that kind of followed up to this embedding program. And accessing these camps, these military boot camps, was not open to anyone. The military essentially hired a firm called the Rendon Group to screen and rank applicants as positive, negative, or neutral. And only positives were essentially accepted into the program. And there were powerful incentives for news corporations to want their journalists to embed. And this is because, you know, essentially provided a production subsidy to news corporations, right? Because embedded journalists had access to Department of Defense provisioned information, photo ops, and like a structured relationship. And second, they may have perceived that they were more likely to get, that their people would get inside information because military personnel knew that these were approved and trusted journalists. And third, embeds received protection, while non-embeds or non-embedded journalists risk being shot at or could be at risk of being misidentified as enemy combatants. And more profoundly, I think, embedding journalists were provided exclusive access to the life world of war from the perspective of the military. They were taught a range of survival skills, like how to use gas masks, how to prepare for a chemical attack, how to paint their faces in camouflage, how to avoid detection, how to escape a minefield, perform first aid, use a compass, build a desert lantern. They were also shown a bunch of high-tech weaponry and trained to use military acronyms and given the opportunity to test out media equipment in. They were chauffeured around in Humvees and encouraged to shoot, record, and transmit heroic, sanitized, spectacular images of soldiers in real time and live broadcasts from the point of view of soldiers. And at the same time, they were restricted from showing content related to, you know, troop size, location, aircraft or weaponry, future operations, and so forth. And relatedly, the Department of Defense did place constraints on what could be reported and would impose media blackouts when news transmissions were perceived to endanger. Excuse me. And I would also add that embedding meant that many of these journalists maintained significant distance from the civilians and adversaries in Iraq and Afghanistan. And when they were in proximity, these people were presented as adversaries not to be trusted. So I think it cultivated a number of problematic effects. And so the embedded program, I would say, overall had sort of three key effects. It served to generate journalistic identification with coalition forces. By embedding these journalists, they were more likely to feel that they were part of the war and not detached observers from it. And then in their day-to-day life in military barracks, they were separated from the host society. They were protected by the military. They developed an intimate connection, if not were inculcated into this kind of band of brothers culture. And it's arguably neutralized critical faculties of objectivity and professionalism within journalism. I think it also generated significant content material for content that could be used by journalists to present war. So the embed milieu constantly generated content in the form of human interest stories and battle stories and photo ops. And there was no need to risk going under the wire to get a story. And third, I'd say it controlled what journalists reported about the war and how they represented it. If you had access, you were already on the inside, which influenced what reporting consisted of. And more importantly, the military was also looking over your shoulder, or worse, telling you what is newsworthy. And so I have a couple of quotes here that hopefully you've read while I've been talking, because I won't get into them, but I think they're emblematic of some of these issues. So another thing is that there's a way in which there was a strategy of controlling information by the Department of Defense. And that involved creating an information center. And the US military built one, the first one. This is the picture of the one in Hilton, the Hilton Kuwaiti Resort, which then later was moved to Doha, Qatar, and staffed with Marines and Navy and Air Force and Army personnel. And they would essentially generate content that was considered friendly material. Press releases, casualty reports, conference talks, interview opportunities with public affairs personnel and DOD journalists. And essentially, somewhere in the neighborhood of 6,500 journalists were provided military-generated information through these centers. Relatedly as well, they have a defense video and imagery information center that essentially produced a huge amount of content, somewhere in the neighborhood of over 70,000 pieces of video news that was created essentially by the Department of Defense. And often this material, okay, thanks. This material was, where it came from was actually not included in its dissemination. So again, it was like DOD spin being presented as news. Okay, I'm gonna have to skip ahead here. I won't get into the pseudo events, but we can talk about that later, but actually creating events that really did not happen remotely, how they were presented. Coercion of non-aligned journalists. There's like documented coercion as well that I think is worth talking about. But again, I think I'm like kind of out of time. So, but it kind of circles back to the issue of how a number of journalists that are part of news corporations that the US military came increasingly to view as adversarial would actually almost treat them as though they were like enemy combatants. So let me just wrap up. So, in conclusion, you know, we have this question of like, why, you know, like why did all of this happen? Why does this continue to happen? And I think that we can understand the reason why the defense and military strategists engage in these practices, but we also want to think about like why news outlets comply. Surely if like fewer complied, with the terms of like the embedding program, for example, and questions its inconsistency with journalistic independence and integrity, it would be less viable. But I think we can point to sort of three issues. The first is the concentration of corporate ownership and the drive for profit. The Department of Defense material support and protection made the work easier and reduced production costs, labor costs, saves time, increases usable content, since it's easy to generate and itself is generated by the Department of Defense. The painstaking work of investigation, the need to learn the historical, political, and cultural context are essentially wiped away. And instead, time can be focused on human interest stories and infotainment, which is then passed off as news, and which is largely non-disruptive politically. The second reason is ideological, something that Radhika sort of pointed to in her opening comments. The scholars of communication and media studies, which is I'm not a scholar of communication and media studies, but many of them do argue that journalistic professionalism has strayed from its core values as the fifth estate to check power. It's become incredibly dependent on reporting with and from official sources, and often treating non-official sources as less credible. And I think also an assumption within the media that viewers are patriotic and would see sort of critical reporting as anti-American or anti-Western and dismiss it on these grounds. And in this case, I think we could say that patriotism is then reduced to supporting the troops and relates to a deeply entrenched view of Western exceptionalism, where displays of Western force are assumed to be on the good side of global power without actually interrogating that. And the last thing I would say is that I think it speaks to the problem of militarism and militarization. That is how militaristic values and allegiances are substituted, essentially, for values of civic engagement and democracy. In contrast, the idea that questioning power is perhaps, and I would argue, is what it means to be part of a political community rather than some kind of breach. It also speaks to or raises questions of how war is a pervasive value in and of itself, not only a means to an end. And we see this in the continuous preparation for war, in weapons, training, resourcing, the selling of war, where, you know, for example, Canada is very involved in selling arms all over the place, including to Saudi Arabia, Ukraine, and so forth, but also the constant actioning of war, including the wars that are undeclared, shadowy, contingent, involving special operations, drones, hit and run attacks, and the financing of wars from without, and where public awareness of whether and with whom we're at war is often unclear or unknown. But I think also by threatening war, seeing problems as only solvable through coercion. So, all of this, I think, speaks to the ways in which militarism is embedded in society and core aspects of how we communicate, govern, and function, all of which are obviously huge challenges for the quest for peace. Thank you. And I'm sorry that I took too much time.
Not at all, Colleen. That was fascinating. And of course, we are dying to hear more from you in the question and answer session, especially on the bits that you had to skip. But let's now go to our next speaker, which is Yves Engler. Yves is very well known, of course, on the Canadian left and in the study of Canadian foreign policy. He has really taken on the task of chronicling from a critical perspective Canadian foreign policy and its wrongs for decades, I think, now. In recent years, I think in the last two or three years, he has, along with Bianca Mugueni, started the very important Canadian Foreign Policy Institute, which I'm sure many of you already follow. Yves has been called Canada's version of Noam Chomsky, one of the most important voices on the Canadian left, of working, quote, in the mold of I.F. Stone, unquote, and many other wonderful types of praise have been heaped upon him, leftist gadfly, etc. Yves has written many books about Canadian foreign policy, and his latest book is called Stand on Guard for Whom? A People's History of the Canadian Military. So Yves, go right ahead.
Thanks a lot, Radhika. Thanks a lot to Peace Alliance Winnipeg and everyone for participating in this. I think that the first thing in understanding the manufacturing of consent for war in Canada, first of all, I think it is important to just point out that Canada has been deeply tied to the main empires of the past three centuries, the British Empire, the U.S. Empire, and Canada's had a particularly close relationship to those empires and has, of course, participated in those empires' wars of conquest, of imperial subjugation, etc. And that Canada is also a leading global capitalist power, most obviously seen in the mining sector, where Canada is a dominant player across the globe. And so Canadian foreign policy is both aligned with empire and advancing Canadian corporate interests abroad. So that's kind of, you know, the big picture of Canadian foreign policy, what drives Canadian foreign policy. But then delving into the question of manufacturing consent for war, I think the first thing that we need to recognize is that the Canadian military is the biggest public relations institution in the country. It's almost never mentioned, incredibly, which is, of course, part of their power in the realm of public relations. We're talking about, the estimates are kind of a little bit all over, but one estimate was 650 people full-time working in the Canadian military on public relations. If you go online, as I did when I did my book, A Propaganda System, There's 50 different public affairs offices across the country that each have one or more public affairs officials working from those. There's the military has dozens of publications. They have a historical section with dozens of historians working in the history department of the military. For decades and decades, most of the important books on Canadian war history were actually published by official historians, which often had to be okayed by cabinet, as that was the case until really until the 1960s, where they really dominated the field. They have their own university, of course, Royal Military College, which also has, you know, many historians, many people working in social sciences of different sorts, which invariably are pro-military kind of ideologues. You have, of course, the Veterans Affairs says they have there's 7,500 war memorials registered with Veterans Affairs. You have more than 60 museums that are part of the Canadian Forces Museum program, which gets space and subsidies by the Canadian military. The military funds dozens of organizations. The Conference of Defense Associations brings together about 50 different militarist associations. Then they fund all kinds of think tanks, obviously the Legion, Canadian Global Affairs Institute, probably the most commonly cited think tank on Canadian military and foreign policy is not only funded by DND, but also funded, of course, by big arms companies. Then you have the fact that most of the security and defense studies programs at Canadian universities were actually set up with military funding, historically through the Security and Defense Forum, which financed, it's like about 15 different security studies programs at different universities across the country. And they continue to be funded by DND's MINES program. The military is pretty open. I mean, you know, if you read someone like David Puglesi, the so-called defense military reporter at the Ottawa Citizen, who's somebody who's, you know, the kind of the critical end of the dominant media, very informed source on Canadian military affairs. Puglesi's reported on multiple occasions, internal government or internal military documents where they talk about the weaponization of public affairs, where they offer exclusives and information to sympathetic journalists, and then they pressure journalists who you know go against what they want to have circulating in the public sphere, including through even to the point of you know contacting editors at newspapers to bring reporters into line. They compile information on like tens of thousands of articles every year on military affairs. So they you know keep tabs on what's being published, keep tabs on what journalists are viewed as sympathetic and less so. They of course have their own Defense Public Affairs Learning Center where they train public affairs officers and they train military officials in PR in spin, and so you know if you go back historically the different wars they always seeking to shape the flow of information. Now how that's played out has changed over time based upon technology, based upon political power and what they can get away with and what the government can do in terms of suppressing information and stuff like that. In recent wars, I think the most interesting ways in which the military has dealt with the information flow is the contrast between the air wars versus the ground war, notably Afghanistan. So in the air wars, if you look at bombing former Yugoslavia in 99, Libya 2011, Iraq, Syria in more recent years, they basically shut the media out. They just completely controlled the flow of information. And they were able to do that in large part because air wars enable that, right? It's very difficult, you know, besides the pilot that's dropping the bomb and you know, maybe those who are telling him or her what to hit. Most people don't know. It's very difficult to find information, you know, what happened. It's happening at, you know, 20, 30,000 feet in the air. So they're able to shut journalists out, and they did that very, very aggressively. Now, and it's actually kind of interesting, as Bob Bergen pointed out in his thing, one of the justifications for some of this was that it goes back to this claim that pilots during the first Iraq war that Canada was part of in the early 90s, that the anti-war activists put body bags on the lawns of some pilots, which is almost for sure not true. But that was actually the justification given, like security, basically the security of our personnel kind of justification for sort of not offering up pilots to be interviewed and the like. Now, in Afghanistan, they took a complete opposite, right? And they brought the journalists as close to the military as possible. And as Colleen pointed out with the embedding program in the US, the Canadian military followed something very similar. They had trainings of journalists before leaving to Afghanistan. And then they basically, you know, had the journalists, you know, with the military, and they were just feeding the journalists the information that they wanted to appear. You know, some journalists, there was varying degrees of how willing the journalists were to play along. Some journalists got kicked out, of course. Prominent journalists got kicked off the base for reporting things that the military was unhappy about. But that's in recent wars how they've operated. And again, all this is very studied, right? The military's studying all this stuff. They're calculating again based upon what they can get away with, what, you know, technological developments, etc. Now, historically, there was very aggressive censorship, right? World War One, there was formal censorship. World War Two, there was formal censorship. And in the Korean War, the early 1950s, there was censorship in theater, meaning in Korea and in Japan. And during World War One, they actually shuttered 253 publications, right? They were like banning, they were going in like taking music, you know, banning music. And they were looking at, you know, people's mail, and, you know, thousands, there were literally actually 1,000 plus people working at looking at people's mail and going through it to, you know, ensure that soldiers sending stuff home weren't necessarily telling information that was unwanted. So there's a real history of aggressive formal censorship during Canadian wars, which fortunately we don't have anymore. I'll get to a little bit with some of what we're seeing on Ukraine at the end, and some of the rise of these very repressive dynamics. But if you look at, you know, Canadian press, okay, so recently Pierre Poilievre made his, you know, stupid comments about Canadian press being this, you know, state CBC wire service kind of comment, which of course is partly untrue, but it's also partly true. If you look at the history of Canadian press, it was actually established during World War One by Canadian government funding to increase British propaganda to the West, and specifically Reuters. So at that time, Associated Press was often making its way into Western Canada. But the U.S. wasn't at war initially, and so they wanted a more hardline pro-military perspective. And so the Canadian government funded, basically created Canadian Press. And then Canadian Press became the dominant wire service in the country during World War II. As one historian put it, it cemented itself as the top wire service by cultivating unprecedentedly close relations with Canada's military authorities, and which went against traditional notions of journalistic independence. The most famous World War II journalist was initially a Canadian Forces public relations officer, Bill Bross, and then he just becomes, he's with a unit as a formal propagandist of the Canadian military, and then starts working for Canadian Press. right? With the same unit, right? So this is like, you know, the integration is really deep, and that's part of how Canadian Press became a dominant a wire service. And I think you see some of the legacy of that right up to today. Similar kind of dynamic with the CBC, right? The CBC's led for 13 years after World War II by Arnold Davidson, Danton, who was the general manager of the government's wartime information board during World War II. In the PhD thesis, I believe, maybe it's master's, titled War on the Air, CBC TV and Canada's Military, 1952 to 1992, Mallory Schwartz points example after example of the CBC just working like deeply with the Canadian military, where they had military officials were working on programs. And I don't think it's the relationship's quite as tight today, but there is that broad historical dynamic, and you see a lot of that, you know, continuing on, deep relationships between the CBC and the military. Davide Mestrice with Passage, online left publication 2 years ago, he did a look at Canadian editorial boards' coverage of Canadian wars and interventions. It's titled "Canadian Editorial Boards Are Cheerleaders for War," and he noted that editorial boards have supported Canada's war and regime change efforts since the First World War 98% of the time. Right, 98% of the time. So he went and actually looked at the Globe, the Montreal Gazette, the Star, Ottawa Citizen, National Post, and what their editorial boards had said about different military interventions. I think it's like about 8 or 10 that he looked at interventions. And they basically all twice, the Toronto Star, the first or their second Iraq War, 2003, the Toronto Star opposed that. And then the Toronto Star also opposed the bombing campaign on Libya or on Iraq, Syria in 20 that began in 2014. So it's you know, obviously the news section wouldn't be quite as extreme as the editorial boards, but it's still nonetheless it's pretty extreme. And to bring it up into a little bit closer today, just before Russia invaded 18 months ago, which I consider a, you know, a violation of international law and brutal, I did a piece on Murray Brewster, who is the lead military reporter for the CBC. He was longtime Canadian Press international defense reporter. And I basically looked, I looked at it from the lens of, I'm often like unsure about individual reporters, what they know and like what goes into, you know, their propaganda. And because you don't know if they're just ignorant, you don't know if they're lazy or if they're really like consciously part of the, you know, militarist ethos. And so Brewster, this has been like, you know, 2 months of growing tensions around, you know, Russian troops on the border, Russia pushing for negotiations, the U.S. ignoring the Russian question around, you know, NATO expansion, et cetera. And so Brewster is just publishing multiple pieces, you know, whipping up this sort of this pro-NATO kind of position, anti-Russia position. And I basically said, well, if Murray Brewster just would have been really lazy and would have just regurgitated what he himself had written before, it would have helped the Canadian public much, much more in terms of understanding what was going on than what he actually reported. So Brewster was the individual who a year after Yanukovych, Viktor Yanukovych was ousted in a Canadian US-backed coup in 2014, he was the reporter that detailed how opposition Maidan protesters, including far right, he didn't report that, but that's come out in other venues, that opposition protests used the Canadian embassy, which is near Maidan Square in Kyiv, they used it as a base of operations for more than a week to try to oust, ultimately a successful ousting of the government. And that was just one piece of Canada's multifaceted engagement in the removal of a, what Canada itself considered an elected president. Brewster also reported on in the 2008, the NATO summit in 2008, where the George W. Bush administration pushed for Ukraine to join NATO, and Harper also pushed for Ukraine to join NATO. So Brewster reported on that, and he reported on the fact that Russia was very hostile to that, and even the French government, German government, you know, understood this as just, you know, hyper provocative. Murray Brewster also reported on the fact that Canada was training, had been training Azov Battalion, and, you know, sort of through the Operation Proteus, which undermined the Minsk II peace accord, that they'd been training these far right forces in Ukraine, and how that was, you know, also controversial. So he'd reported all this before a couple months before Russia's invasion. But in all his reports, at that period when there was real, like, you know, the war drums were beating, he doesn't talk about any of this stuff. So he's obviously not ignorant of it. If he was lazy, it would have been much easier just to regurgitate what he'd already reported. So you have to just assume that he understood that it's one thing to, you know, a year after Yanukovych is ousted, to, you know, report on Canada's role in violating international law and helping oust Yanukovych, which of course led to, you know, fighting war in eastern Ukraine. But it's a whole other thing to report that same information when, you know, we're really moving towards this big NATO proxy war. So you have to just assume Brewster is a conscious militarist, you know, ideologue, propagandist, if you like. Another thing, just an example of, you know, recent stuff on the NATO proxy war. Now, look for a Canadian media outlet that's reported on what former Israeli Prime Minister Naftali Bennett, Turkish Foreign Minister, Ukrainian media reported on about. There was basically negotiations a month into the fighting, and there was an agreement that, as Naftali Bennett put it, that the West sabotaged. Right? Not, you can't find that in any Canadian media, or I haven't found it in any Canadian media. Right? So this context of Canada's role, you know, with regards to provoking the war, and then the context of how NATO, and specifically US, Canada, Britain, the main hawks in the, you know, driving forces of the hawkishness within NATO, that they, or at least the powerful forces, you could argue some of the Eastern European countries as well, but the powerful forces within NATO.
My bad, Yves, but you are at nearly 20 minutes, just letting you know.
Yeah, I'll get towards
it. I should have said 15 earlier, but I forgot.
I'll get towards the conclusion here. And so they just, it's just not reported, right? So the Canadian, you know, Canadian media just publishes endless stories of what's going on, but pretty fundamentally important information about, you know, a negotiated solution that would have, you know, still had a fair bit of people that had died, but you would have, you know, much, much less than what we're at now. And that's just not reported in the Canadian media. So the context that would help the Canadian public make sense of what's going on, and specifically Canada's role, is just basically expunged from the dominant media. Now, what we've seen in the last in recent months, I would say, is kind of a remarkable return to just the open suppression of anti-war discussion. And it was obviously most obvious with Dmitry Lascaris's tour across the country, which I guess was about 6 weeks, 2 months ago, where he was, Vince, I know in Winnipeg, there's two different venues shut down, in Montreal, Toronto, there was efforts, just remarkable efforts, to shut down all of the venues. And there was different forces driving that. There was, I think, kind of like two broad forces, which is this milieu of academic sort of intellectual that are dependent on Canadian government, specifically Canadian military funding and U.S. government funding. People like Marcus Kolga from the McDonnell Laurier Institute, which his disinformation project was set up explicitly with U.S. embassy funding, people like Jean-Christophe Boucher, who was, he received more than $1 million in Canadian military funding for his different academic work. These individuals were really aggressive online and pushing to shut events down. And then simultaneously you had sort of the Ukrainian Canadian Congress and sort of milieus tied to the UCC. And they were very successful. They were successful and like remarkably so at pressuring outlets. And I would say this is kind of like a step backward in time on Canadian sort of for anti-war activists. I'd say that like after, you know, into the mid 60s, the climate was hyper repressive. I mean, they even killed people right during World War I who were opposing the war, and obviously threw all kinds of people in jail in World War II and World War I. And that dynamic, I think, had really been broken up by the 60s, late 60s, and sort of anti-NATO, pro-peace positions became, you know, obviously not dominant in decision making, but pretty, you know, acceptable or respected in mainstream kind of political life. And that, I think, what we've seen in recent months is that space has really sort of died down. I think it's partly because over the past 15 years, the anti-war movement hasn't really been active. No, there hasn't been many major mobilizations since I think there was a big one in 2008 to mark the 50th anniversary of U.S. invasion of Iraq against Canada's role in Afghanistan and Iraq. That was, I think, the last sort of major mobilization. Libya, we didn't see major demonstrations. So I think that's very dangerous. And of course, you know, the way to reverse that is to, you know, mobilize and to rekindle the anti-war movement. But at the big picture, we need to look at, you can't understand any of this stuff without understanding the political economy of Canadian foreign policy and of peace and anti-war and, versus war. So the war movement, the military funded or arms funded institutions, they literally have hundreds of millions of dollars, towards $500 million a year is around that is spent by the military or Veterans Affairs in, you know, war celebrations, in public relations, in the like. The anti-war movement, on the other hand, you know, has, I don't know, maybe a couple $100,000, right? There's basically no one that's full-time doing this work paid. Maybe World Beyond War has one employee. It's, you know, very few. So that's the political economy of these questions is central. And again, the only way to reverse this is just by organizing, by mobilizing, and rekindling anti-war activism. I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
That's really great. Thank you so much, Yves. So I think we are now ready to go into the question and answer session. If those of you who would like to pose questions, if you could just use the raise hand function, because if you just do this, I may not be able to see you. So if there are questions, please go ahead. Anyone? Maybe, yes, Laura, please go ahead.
Well, it's not really so much of the question. It's just what I've seen happening, too, is it's not just the mainstream media not who are totally bought into the war machine, but programs like, for example, Democracy Now!, which I don't know if you're all familiar with it, probably, which I've watched for many years. And I don't know if I've become a more astute viewer or if it's just that I'm increasingly aware of also just the poor quality of the journalism, how much it reveals bias, but also, I don't know, maybe just reveals poor quality journalism. But like, for example, that I've noticed recently in a number of episodes, for example, when Russia did not extend the grain agreement again, because it had abided by it and we had not. Instead, Democracy Now! Just presents it as they just withdrew from this agreement and now there's hunger in the world, you know, without ever mentioning that we were the ones that hadn't abided by it. Similarly, when they're in Iran, where there were women demonstrations, which I'm very sympathetic to, but when there were some young men who were executed because they had apparently taken part in things that had murdered security personnel. Instead, she just presents it like they were out protesting and then they were executed. And while the judicial process seemed highly flawed, I thought you at least have to say what they were accused of and what they were charged with, and then discuss how flawed the judicial process is. They don't just present it like they were, you know, protesting and then they were executed. And I've just noticed on so many instances now where they don't even ask questions, like when Prigozhin was killed. When they have this interview with this woman who immediately assumes that Putin did it, and how, oh, this is so keeping in Putin's character. So they did the whole interview without ever asking her, well, how do you know he did it? They had so many enemies. There were so many things that were a bit peculiar about it, but not asking a single question like that. And I felt like, well, so, you know, for even, unfortunately, people often go to democracy now, as it's one of the few things you can watch. It's like a daily news program. But I don't know if you've noticed that, but I find that even sometimes more dismaying than what I've already given up on the mainstream media. But anyway, it's not a question. It's just something I've noticed that I find alarming.
No, absolutely. And I'm sure that Yves and Colleen would like to comment on it. So please go ahead.
I'll take the first bit at it. Yeah, I mean, I've watched a lot of that. I saw that thing on Prigozhin, I guess 2 days ago or whatever it was, and it was pretty remarkable. If you look at Democracy Now!, they've had Khrushchev's granddaughter, I believe, on multiple times. And she's also a regular columnist in the Globe Mail, right? Which I just find kind of funny that they... But you know, I don't like there's obviously a sort of Russiagate element to this in the US particularly. And, you know, I've the trauma that a segment of sort of liberal left US milieu had by Trump. And there was, you know, they haven't recovered, and they really bought into a lot of this business of, you know, it was the Russians that made Trump our president, kind of thing. So that's an element that I think that the sort of tightening geopolitical winds of has just heightened this stuff kind of across the board, and you know, growing kind of Cold War with China, or conflict with China has kind of seeped in, you know, across political milieus. I also think you probably are more astute. I think if you go back, it's more recently where I've started like listening to Democracy Now! I didn't like listen to Democracy Now!, you know, in the early 2000s or in 2008 or whatever. But I know from a Canadian perspective, you know, I did a book on left-right marching to the beat of Imperial Canada. And, you know, the NDP, you know, this isn't new, right? The CCF, where like right away back NATO, right away back the Korean War. There's this, you know, unions were way more like pro-military and pro-war then than they are today. And, you know, I think today they're not doing very good on that issue, that front. So this isn't new that like leftish forces or social democratic forces, or even what I find kind of a bit more fascinating is the anarchist forces today. A whole swath of the sort of anarchist online milieu really is just kind of pro NATO. That's pretty fascinating. But it's not new. These broader dynamics are not something that's new to you know, the left or progressive world, or whatever you want to call it exactly.
Colleen, did you want to add something?
I think Laura maybe had a hot pursuit. Did you, Laura? Did you want to go first? Oh, you're muted.
It can seem quite hopeless, but do you think, like, so much with young people now really going onto social media, not watching mainstream news, not watching newspapers, Does that something that gives us hope for the future? Or do you think there's now so much censorship and it's going to, you know, it already is, and it's probably going even further, that maybe that's an illusion that's hopeful as well?
Well, I guess, I don't know if I can speak to that, but I could say, you know, one of the one of the difficulties I think that you highlighted in your comments was that journalism, a lot of journalism these days, and even some sort of critical journalism, is not focused on just establishing the facts that then we can use as a basis to make judgments, right? And so, and I think what's also going on is that, you know, villain narratives are very seductive, right? They clarify a very messy, complicated, historically rich kind of like situation, right? So if you can deduce what's happening in Ukraine to, you know, Putin being a megalomaniac villain that is terrible, then it just kind of tells you a sequence of things that you should then also assume and do, right? And so I think it is very seductive. And I think even when you get journalism that's trying to maybe not entirely buy into that, it often seems to be presented front and center, right? Like, even if we're going to acknowledge that there are some other issues going on with, you know, Prigozhin or whatever, ultimately everything kind of comes back to this one issue, whether it's like, you know, Putin and Russia, or whether it's like the Iranian regime being evil, you know? And so I think it clarifies things for some people, and it's obviously not what we want or would expect from any media. And so like, you know, but I sort of understand it, right? It sort of parrots what's going on in a lot of the mainstream media, reproduces it, and then doesn't really, unfortunately, provide a whole lot more that would help us to understand how it is that we've come to a circumstance in which all of these countries are essentially at war with Russia, you know, through proxy means. And every month that goes by, we get one step closer to like even more sort of direct confrontation. So, and I guess the last thing I would say is that I think that militaristic values and allegiances are so incredibly central to like how people engage in answering difficult questions about problems in the, like big problems in the world, big power inequalities and so forth. And so I think that's also an issue that is of some importance to me, and I think other people here, which is like how militaristic ideas and values get embedded into so much of how we come to understand the world or see solutions to problems.
Great, thanks. I've just had a request from Javni Moore to read out her question because they can't ask it themselves. So here's the question. They say, I'm curious about the extent to which those of us in or as the broad collective of Marxist tradition may or may not reach a political analysis that overly stresses the effort of the state. Effort of the state to manufacture consent, I think is what is meant. Following Samir Amin, that imperialism walks on two legs, economic and military, and Paulo Freire and Fanon, that the activity of oppressing or holding a position superior to a constructed subaltern, such as a native or a slave, inherently also produces the devolution of the oppressor. It seems to me that the consent of the settler class in so-called Canada and the US did not need much manufacturing, but rather they are over the intergenerational long history of colonization, not only standing at the ready for any and every moralizing justification of their state's violence and their superior positionality in the hierarchy of humanity, but maybe past the point where the imperialist state needs to make much effort. So I think the general idea is that, you know, given Canada's history as a settler state, and for that matter, that of the United States, I mean, this is just, you know, a continuation of a very long history. How much preparation really do we need to create among those who identify as settlers to go to war? So maybe your reaction in any order.
Well, I'll start. First of all, I just want to just answer Laura's question part really quickly. I think that we have the means of disseminating information like we've never had. And the extent to which the military forces have pressured Facebook, pressured Twitter, pressured the social media to suppress speaks to the fact that they're very nervous about that, right? And so like there is a hope in that, whether, you know, how useful that is, we can have some debates about it, but there is a fundamental hope in there. Now, yesterday, when I went to the library with my 1.5-year-old daughter, I go there and I get newspapers and we go to the kids section of the basement and she kind of hangs out and I read newspapers and we play and whatever. She picked up IT Progrès newspaper. When I went to the newspaper section on the first floor, she picks up IT Progrès newspaper, take it down the stairs. And I joke to the woman at the counter that Zuri is really interested in Haitian news. Okay, this woman of, you know, Quebecoise, Francophone woman. And her response was, well, at least some people still have a care for them. We can tell that Haitians, at least some people have a care for them. And what was essentially this hyper paternalistic, like totally well-meaning, but just hyper paternalistic comment about Haiti that like literally is an inverse of like certainly the last 25 years of Canadian policy in Haiti and longer than that, right? Where we've just been terrorizing Haitians. But this person, again, I believe totally well-meaning. That's her immediate reaction to this little joke I made about IT Progrès newspaper, which I think speaks exactly to this point of this, like, this is just like, you know, white supremacist, colonial kind of ideology is just so pervasive. It's so easy to tap into by politicians, by media, whenever they want to do whatever they want to do in Haiti is be at the extreme end of that. And there's many other examples that are, you know, not as extreme as Haiti. Now I'm going to completely go in the other direction. Now, in the early times of war in Ukraine, a common left criticism, right, of people who I would say who basically knew that Canada was not doing good things but were very scared to say, oh, this is a proxy war, that, you know, Canada, US have pushing NATO expansion, didn't want to get into this with the geopolitical thing. What they sort of said, their how they kind of criticized it in a backdoor way was to point out the racism. Right, to point out how, you know, the Eastern European countries and Canada and others were taking in these white refugees, and it was, you know, also they would talk a little bit about the racism within Ukraine and how there were African students who were being blocked to come out, all of which, of course, was you know, a significant degree of truth to, right? You contrast how Canada has accepted Ukrainian refugees versus you know, Haitian or many different places, right? You point, it's clear there's racism in there. But that's really like, I think the geopolitics clearly subsumes it. And, you know, there were 7 years of fighting where white people, very white, you know, generally ethnic Russians were being hit in the Donbass, were victims of you know, violence. And the Canadian media like just didn't talk about it at all. So to me, you know, racism is clearly a part of understanding this, and there's elements of, but geopolitics it trumps that in this context, I think, quite clearly, because the media is able to just literally eliminate the violence against, you know, that to a large extent, predominant extent, the government of Kyiv was perpetrating against you know, very white ethnic Russians in the Donbass. So I think we do, you know, there's that point, I think, is, you know, heavily true, and in lots of cases it really fits. But I also think there's broader dynamics that we do also need to keep in mind.
Thanks. Colleen, please go ahead. And then I would like to ask a couple of questions. So, yeah.
I think I was just going to, I'm not sure if I fully caught. It was more of a comment, I think, than a question. But I was going to say, like, obviously, it's incredibly important to think about how the history of settler coloniality involved forms of violence that, you know, were rewritten into these narratives of, like, helping Indigenous people, you know, civilize, right? These kind of civilizational sort of narratives. how they get reproduced in different ways in a kind of geopolitical structure, but also in terms of continuing this narrative of Western superiority that I think you can actually trace through, you know, a lot of this. And so I think pointing out those connections, how these like particular logics and these kind of relations actually kind of continue on is incredibly important. And in many ways, I thought the comment was kind of speaking to the importance of that, which I definitely agree with. I think another thing I would just add about this question of, you know, we have more capacity that Yves kind of brought up about, you know, more capacity to disseminate information than we've ever had. And yet we have like, you know, all of these interesting twists and turns in terms of like how the media functions. I also think that the government has more capacity in certain ways to control information than it ever had. And I'm thinking here a little bit about, you know, I have a student who's doing some research on the Canadian Security Establishment, which is a highly secretive organization that many Canadians didn't even know existed for a very long time, and doing a lot of ATIP requests, access to information requests. And what's very interesting, even though there's some good movements right now to try to open up access to information, is that now, because of this kind of technologization of security, all of these different agencies, whether it's Communication Security Establishment, CSIS, the RCMP, Global Affairs Canada, Public Safety, they all now share what each other is divulging more than ever before. It's not that they weren't doing some of this before, but I think they have like a really facilitating platform in which to check what each other is like redacting in access to information requests and align themselves with what other agencies are doing, ultimately producing like less access to information for people who are looking for it to be able to understand what's happening. So I just wanted to throw that out there as like an issue.
Yeah, if I may, I have to say, of course, both the presentations were so rich and they've raised so many questions, but I'm going to try and keep myself to a general question directed to both of you and then a particular question directed to each of you. So So basically, it seems to me, and this is not something I had thought of earlier, but as you were talking, it seemed to me that, you know, if you are creating, if you're manufacturing consent for war, and as you say, it begins a lot earlier, you're absolutely right. And I would say one of the key forms it takes is actually the demonization of the other. I mean, as has come up in our discussion, the fact of the matter is that the demonization of Putin began a long time before the war. I mean, I remember this, listening to this interview in which Biden just said Putin is a killer. I mean, you know, whatever. And this guy said, you called him a killer? And he says, yes, I called him a killer. Well, I mean, Putin is no more a killer than Biden is a killer. I mean, in that sense, you know, so, you know, they have all engaged in the killing of, you know, through their the command over military structures, etc. So the anti-Putin rhetoric has been going on for such a long time, particularly after 2014, and then particularly in the run-up to this. So I'd like you to comment on that in particular, because of course, once you dehumanize somebody, then anything can be justified in relation to them, you know. And quite frankly, it's not just Putin. Russians are being dehumanized by the attack on Russian culture and so on, in a way that I don't think Germany was dehumanized when we were in the Second World War. You know, fascism was always distinct from the legacy of German culture and so on and so forth. So that is something. So that's a general point I wanted you to both to comment on. And then I'd like Colleen, if possible, if you could say something more about the pseudo events you didn't get to talk about. And then Yves, in your case, if you might just say something about the recent anti-China stuff that is being, you know, sort of the ground is being laid in our country for aggression against China, which may be justified by all this talk about, you know, I mean, the parliament passing a resolution saying there's genocide in Xinjiang without really listening to, you know, basically listening to one side, if at all. I mean, you know, in a completely summary way, in a way that even the Guardian had to say, look, you know, you can't just declare a genocide. There has to be a serious research into it. And then, of course, there's all this stuff about alleged Chinese police stations and blah, blah, and so on, and Chinese interference in Canadian politics. So if you could comment on how you read that, that would be very helpful. Thanks.
Do you want me to start?
Why not? Yeah.
Okay. Well, let me just say something about the pseudo event. I'll start there. So I guess one example that I didn't get to talk to about a pseudo event was the story of Jessica Lynch, which many of you might remember. So she was a passenger on a convoy of Humvees that crashed and came under fire in Iraq, in Nasiriyah, and she was injured and subsequently rescued actually by Iraqis and taken to a hospital where she had her injuries treated. But the director of the Coalition Information Center, Jim Wilkinson, essentially revised the events to be a very different story, which was that, you know, Lynch was, the story was that she heroically fled the Humvees, engaged in a firefight against Iraqis. And they claimed that she was apprehended by Iraqis, that she was stabbed and raped. And the DOD actually produced like a rescue video depicting her as being heroically saved by Navy SEALs. And none of these were true. And like media outlets like the Washington Post and so forth, like they ran this story and this account of the events as though they were fact. And she actually came out and publicly criticized the military for misrepresenting her experience. She testified before a congressional committee on oversight and government reform, where she said like the DOD had erroneously portrayed her as like a Rambo from the hills of West Virginia. And NBC actually, nonetheless, despite all of this, actually came out and created a, like a made for TV film, which you can all go and watch, called Saving Private Lynch. And another pseudo event I think that's important because it's widely seen differently, I think, is the so-called liberation of Iraq. So the picture that everyone sees of, you know, people like Iraqis, but also some military, U.S. military personnel kind of shrouding a statue, a fallen statue of Saddam Hussein in an American flag. So this depiction was, you know, run over many media outlets, but essentially it was actually an ordered event that there was like a Marine corporal who essentially said that he was ordered to wrap the face of Saddam Hussein in the U.S. flag. And then he was also told to encourage Iraqis to congregate around and attack the statue. And so it was this kind of orchestrated event. And I'm sure there's many others, but interestingly, even though the truth has kind of come out, I still think the misleading representation of what happened is actually what continues to be dominant, which is very interesting and concerning. And I guess speaks to that issue of who has the resources to actually find, to, you know, get the airtime to tell their stories. With respect to the question of like, I agree with your characterization of this kind of demonization of the other. And I think part of it was like, relates to what I said earlier about like this kind of these villain narratives being very convenient and useful because they can be very ahistorical and also very decontextualized and provide simple set of actions that one must then take or one can assume. But I think what's interesting about the broader dehumanization of Russians in all of this is something that we see around like the sanctions regime, right? So sanctions have been used against Russia, and there's this kind of narrative attached to it, like, well, the Russians are finally going to like notice what their stupid government's doing and be able to change it, and we'll do that by denying them things that they need to survive or like hitting them where it hurts. But of course, like sanctions are like actually, you know, like the humanitarian consequences of sanctions in so many cases are terrible and don't really do that much to change the government in many instances. And so I think this is an interesting moment where there's an assumption that sanctions are actually a good thing, even though they ultimately hurt people who may not really have a lot of power to be able to change what's happening. But they can allow Western governments to be seen to be like doing something, not that they're not already doing a lot, and also seen as like this alternative, that it's not coercive. It's not a use of coercive force, when I think that is not necessarily a fair characterization.
And I have to add to that, you're absolutely right. And I just one additional thought, which is that because Russians have not reacted by mobilizing to overthrow Putin as in the fantasy of the West, increasingly I'm hearing in the mainstream media, in the BBC, The Guardian, etc., commentary that says there's something wrong with Russians. They are accepting it. They are like sheep, you know, whatever. And this is quite, can't remember the exact phrasing, but there is a definite implication. But yeah, Yves, please go ahead.
Well, I would just say on the sort of demonization at a big picture level, you know, we don't have to go back very far. And the foreign interference, government set up a whole like task force, I think it was just before the 2019 election. And it was all about Russian foreign interference, right? And then it's amazing how quickly that's just all morphed to now it's China, right? And to get to the question of like China and what's happened in the Canadian media over the past few years, it's absolutely remarkable. I mean, the Globe and Mail, what happened to the Globe and Mail, I can't point the date it begins, but it's something like 2000, you know, January 1st, 2000, like was there a phone call between the head of the CIA and is it Crawley or whatever his name is, the publisher at I don't know, maybe went to the Thompson family, like, but it becomes just like remarkable how whipped up about China, and mostly it's the two, you know, Chase anyway, forgetting his the guy who was named in the Maharar inquiry as being the vehicle for CSIS's lies, as the vehicle for CSIS's lies, is, you know, obviously continuing that on China today. But yeah, so the China stuff on the media front, and you notice that. So to me, I mean, the Globe sort of plays a central role in really picking this up a couple years ago, going very, you know, done in a sort of sophisticated-y kind of way that the Globe, and to see that trickle everywhere, right? Now you have like Marie Vastel at Le Devoir, who's, you know, somebody who's whatever, in terms of corporate media, would be, you know, on the left, far left end of, you see in the Toronto Star, they're all demanding the inquiry into Chinese interference. And it's across the board. There's almost no space to push back. And I mean, you know, the Taiyi or the National Observer, or sort of viewed as sort of more leftward kind of publications, just almost no space to push back against the China demonization, and you have you know, the political parties just completely jumping on board. Just a couple of days ago, Jenny Kwan, the NDP MP for Vancouver East, where I grew up, she's in Toronto launching this foreign agency registry petition for a press conference in Toronto, which is explicitly a response to a parliamentary petition that, you know, a bunch of Canada-China Focus, Canadian Foreign Policy Institute, and others promoted, questioning the whole foreign agency registry and how that's going to be used to demonize Chinese Canadians and anyone who might have some contacts with China, and so you got the NDP, you know, like, full throttle, like activists campaigning against any effort to question the sort of overarching, you know, foreign interference ethos. And like the most progressive thing they'll do when they're getting really, when Jagmeet Singh's being really progressive, what he'll do is say, oh, we shouldn't just focus on China. We should also focus on other official enemies like Russia and Iran. And then he'll throw in India. He's got his own sort of political beef with India. You know, we won't talk about U.S. or Israeli influence in Canada. That's no. But we'll diminish the anti-China element by throwing in a couple other official enemies. That's the far progressive angle from the NDP. So there's no doubt we're going down a pretty remarkable path on setting up for conflict with China, and there is some dissent within the capitalist world. There is some, you know, Canadian mining companies that are pushing back some of the most egregious Canadian mining capitalists who are pushing back, like the head of Barrick Gold and Freeland and Robert Freeland and others. The where we're going on the China and the demonization is pretty remarkable. And I feel like the speed at which it's gone, there's always been this anti-China, this, you know, century old, whatever, but the extent that's been mobilized in the past couple of years is pretty remarkable.
Yeah, I think you meant to say 2020, not 2000. I think you meant
2020. Yes, yes.
2020. But no, totally. So, if there are no other questions, we are just about at the 90-minute mark since we began, so I can perhaps draw this to a close. Yuri, you have a question. I'll permit one question. Quick, please go ahead.
Sure, no problem. Thank you, Professor. Thank you to the organizers. Thank you, Yves and Dr. Bell, for great presentation discussion. My very quick question is to Dr. Bell. Now, you're originally from the United States, correct?
No, I'm not.
Oh, okay. Well, my question anyways, though, is because you talked a lot in your presentation about, you know, the American media, I didn't just have to ask, what do you think it's going to take for the U.S. to focus, for the U.S., its media, but also the people power movements there to focus more on the plight of Native Americans, the way, you know, it is a big topic of discussion in, you know, in Canada, and trying to reckon with that brutal past and very, you know, terrible presence.
Well, I would sort of love to turn the question back to you and ask you that question. I don't have any particularly unique insight on the American context in terms of it as a settler colonial state, but I do think, I do think you see a lack of concern or even questioning or even framing of issues in relation to the United States as a settler colonial state. And I think part of the reason for that, if we want to look at sort of American history a little bit, is that the United States, and I certainly experienced this when I lived in the UK for a while, the United States understands itself as having liberated itself from colonialism, right, through its revolution. And therefore questions around colonialism and are kind of framed through that lens. And what gets missed is the fact that the United States is a kind of colony, like a liberated state that is also a settler colonial state at the same time, right? And that in it, as it supposedly liberated itself, it also engaged in this process of deepening colonial control over Indigenous American people or Indigenous people in sort of that area, that what became the state. And so I think in some ways that's a little bit of the reason, or it helps to explain some of the ways in which issues and questions and struggles around the United States coming to terms with its settler colonial status is sort of gets missed. It doesn't get taken up very seriously compared to Canada, but that's really only one possible, you know, but I would love to hear what you think.
Should I answer, Professor, or?
Very briefly, yeah.
I would just say that at the moment, you know, in the U.S., there is a lot of focus on the plight of Black Americans, which is great, and the plight of, you know, Latinos and immigrants, legal or otherwise, but there just seems to be this sort of I don't know, anti-racism on everything except the Native Americans. I think the U.S., it's very much like a racial caste system, and the Native Americans are sort of like, you know, the untouchables. And I just hope that there will come a day where the people power movements there, the broad left movements there, you know, do speak out against the plight of Native Americans. And hopefully we get to a level that, you know, where better race relations are, like in Canada and New Zealand. Australia also has the exact same problem, although their genocide denialism is, you know, is even worse than the, you know, than the U.S. in that respect.
Great. Well, I think we can probably draw things to a close now. I just wanted to make two quick comments and then bring it to then thank everyone. First is, you know, I really liked what we were discussing, and I think Yves, you mentioned about racism and so on. But I just wanted to add that basically, I think it helps. I mean, of course, racism is an old structure, and it exists exactly in the way that our person who asked the question about colonialism and racism and so on meant. But on top of that, I think racism, it makes much more sense to see it as an ideology you produce to justify your aggression against a group of people, whether they happen to be indigenous or black or brown or whatever. And sometimes they can even be white. I think racism has nothing to do with the color of your skin. The Irish have been racialized in their time. Eastern Europeans are being racialized today. East Germans have been racialized by their own brethren in a variety of ways. So I think that, bearing that in mind, I think that racialization and the kind of dynamics of demonization that we were talking about have a lot to do with one another. And of course, I can say that having been to Russia several times in the last year and a bit, Russians are absolutely gobsmacked at the level of racism that they are receiving at the present time. So that's really interesting. And the second quick point I wanted to make is that, of course, in all of this, it will be just fantastic to throw in the consideration of what social media has done, how much it has distorted our information environment, essentially enabled practically anybody to say anything they like and anybody else to deny anything they like, all in the name of somebody else is producing the fake news and you are producing the real news. And the refusal of our governments to regulate social media, to treat them as the publishers they really are, rather than giving them a free pass for, you know, just being a platform, this refusal has everything to do with the fact that they actually have no interest in the real news getting out in any way. So the truth getting out in any way. So this is part of the whole manufacturing of consent that we are discussing. So anyway, with that thought, I just wanted to say thank you very much to Colleen Bell, Yves Engler. Great presentations, really thought-provoking. I hope that we can continue these and other related discussions further with both of you. Thank you for everyone who came and also asked questions. And thanks to Peace Alliance Winnipeg for organizing this.